oral cavity is the point of entry for digestive and respiratory tracts. The mucous membrane of the mouth consists of squamous epithelium covering the vascularized connective tissue. The epithelium is keratinized over the hard palate, lips and gingiva, while elsewhere it is non-keratinized. Keratinized means they have superficial keratin layer. Mucous gland, that is minor salivary glands, are scattered throughout the oral mucosa. Sebaceous glands are present in the region of the lips and buccal mucosa, and lymphoid tissue is present in the form of tonsils and adenoids. So these are the normal components of the oral cavity. That is squamous epithelium, that covers the vascularized connective tissue, mucous glands, that is minor salivary glands, sebaceous glands and lymphoid tissue. So tumor can arise from any of these components. First discuss some common benign tumors. First example is squamous papilloma. So papilloma can occur anywhere in the mouth and has the usual papillary or finger like projections, and microscopically you can see these are the papillae that composed of this vascularized connective tissue, and that is covered by this squamous epithelium. Second is hemangioma, that is the tumor of the blood vessels, and that can occur anywhere in the mouth, but if it occurs in the tongue, it may cause the macroglossia. It is most commonly three types: capillary type, cavernous type and mixed types. So capillary hemangioma, that shows microscopically the lobules that containing thin wall capillaries and that are lined by the layer of endothelium. So these are the lobules of the capillaries and that are lined by the endothelium. Cavernous type shows the more dilated vessels, and mixed type shows the both the parts. Lymphangioma, that most commonly on the tongue, that produce the macroglossia and can occur in the lips and cheek. Cystic hygroma is a special variety of lymphangioma that occur in children on the lateral side of the neck. As you can see, this is the cystic hygroma that is present on the lateral side of the neck. Microscopically, this lymphangioma is characterized by this large lymphatic spaces. All these are the lymphatic spaces that are lined by the endothelial layer and containing lymph. Then fibroma is the most common benign oral mucous membrane mass, and grossly it shows the discrete superficial pedunculated mass, and it probably arises as a response to physical trauma. And microscopically, fibroma is composed of this collagenic fibrous connective tissue, and that is covered by the squamous epithelium. Okay. Then tumors of minor salivary glands. So minor salivary glands that are present in the oral cavity, they give rise to the salivary tumors that are similar to the major salivary glands. And pleomorphic adenoma is the most common example of minor salivary gland. Then granular cell tumor, earlier called as the granular cell myoblastoma, and it is benign tumor and it is known to be mesenchymal in origin. Most common location is the tongue, but it can occur anywhere in the oral cavity. It occurs exclusively in females, and similar lesion that is seen in infants is termed as the congenital epithelium. Microscopically, the tumor is composed of these large polyhedral cells. These are the large polyhedral cells with granular and acidophilic cytoplasm. And epithelium may show this pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia in the granular cell tumor. So what is pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia? It is a reactive epithelial proliferation that is seen in response to wide variety of conditions, including the infections, neoplasia, inflammation and trauma, and it is characterized by the hyperplasia of the epidermis and adnexal epithelium, and it closely mimics the squamous cell carcinoma. So we have to differentiate between the pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia and squamous cell carcinoma. This is the microscopic picture. This shows this reactive epithelial proliferation of the squamous epithelium. Then oral leukoplakia, that is also known as the white lesions. So leukoplakia or white plaque that may be clinically defined as a white patch or plaque that is present on the oral mucosa and exceeds the 5 mm in diameter, which cannot be rubbed off nor can be classified into any other diagnosable disease. There are a number of other lesions that can be characterized by the formation of white patches, but from the pathologist's point of view, the term leukoplakia is reserved for epithelial thickening, which may range from completely benign to atypical to pre-malignant cellular changes. So leukoplakia basically means any epithelial thickening, that is from completely benign to pre-malignant changes. It most frequently occur in males than the females, and lesions may be of variable size and appearance. Site in decreasing order of frequency, they first affect the cheek mucosa most commonly, then angle of mouth, then alveolar mucosa, then tongue, lip, hard and soft palate, and floor of the mouth. And 4 to 6% cases of leukoplakia shows the carcinomatous changes. However, it is difficult to decide which white lesions may undergo the malignant transformation. But mostly, if it is grossly speckled or nodular form, it is more likely to progress to the malignancy. So, it is desirable that all oral white patches to be biopsied to exclude the malignancy. Etiological factors are similar to those suggested for the oral squamous cell carcinoma, but it has the strongest association with the use of tobacco in the various forms, like in heavy smokers that are using the pipe or cigar smokes, or persons who are chewing the tobacco containing products like pan and pan masala, etc. They have the high risk of this leukoplakia. And the condition is also known by other names such as the smoker's keratosis and stomatitis nicotina. Other etiological factors that are associated are chronic friction, such as with ill-fitting dentures or jacked tooth, local irritants like excessive consumption of alcohol or very hot and spicy foods and beverages, and a special variety of leukoplakia called hairy leukoplakia that is seen in patients of AIDS that has the hairy or corrugated surface, but it is not related to the development of oral cancer. Grossly, lesions of leukoplakia may appear white or whitish yellow or red velvety, more than 5 mm in diameter and variable in appearance. They are usually circumscribed or may be slightly elevated, smooth or wrinkled or speckled or nodular. And as we have seen, that speckle and nodular form have higher chances of pre-malignant changes. Histologically, leukoplakia is of two types, that is hyperkeratosis type and dysplastic type. Hyperkeratosis type shows the keratosis, so increase in the keratin layer, and there is increase in the all the layers, but there is orderly proliferation and intact basement membrane. So this is the hyperkeratosis type. But in dysplastic type, what happens? There is a increase in the all the number of layers, but there is a cytologic atypia in the form of pleomorphism and hyperchromatosis, and also there is a presence of mitosis, but here also intact basement membrane, but it shows the dysplasia. So usually mild dysplasia may revert back to normal. If the offending etiologic factor that we have seen is removed, it will convert to the normal. It will revert back to the normal. Severe dysplasia indicates that the case may progress to the carcinoma. And erythroplasia is a form of dysplastic leukoplakia in which the epithelial atypia is more marked and thus has the higher risk of developing malignancy. So erythroplasia is a severe dysplasia. It shows severe dysplasia. And if the epithelial dysplasia is extensive, so as to involve the entire thickness of the epithelium, the lesion is called the carcinoma in situ and may progress to the invasive carcinoma. Then squamous cell carcinoma. So oral cancer is a disease with very poor prognosis because it is not recognized and treated when it is small and early. So it has very poor prognosis. It comprises 90% of all oral malignant tumors and 5% of all human malignancies. In UK and USA, the age group affected is 55 to 75 years of age, but in India, younger age group, that is 40 to 45 years of age persons are affected. Because oral cancer is very frequent malignancy in India, because habits of betel nut chewing and river smoking. River smoking is burnt end of the hand, rolled the tobacco leaf is put in the mouth. When burnt end of the tobacco leaf is put in the mouth, it is called the river smoking. And that is highly associated with the oral carcinoma. And there is a definite male preponderance. Common sites involved is, first is lower lip is most commonly affected, then tongue, then anterior floor of the mouth, then mucosa over the alveolingual sulcus and palate. So these are the common sites in descending order of frequency. Then etiology. So etiology of squamous cell carcinoma is unknown, but a number of etiological factors have been implicated. It is strongly associated with the tobacco smoking and tobacco chewing that causing the leukoplakia, that is the most important factor. Then chronic alcohol consumption and human papilloma virus infection, particularly 16 and 18 types. And weakly, it is associated with chronic irritation from ill-fitting denture or jagged teeth. Then submucosal fibrosis, that is seen in Indians that are consuming excess of the chilies. Then poor orodental hygiene, nutritional deficiencies, exposure to sunlight, exposure to radiation, and Plummer-Vinson syndrome, that is characterized by the atrophy of the upper alimentary tract. So incidence of squamous cell carcinoma is weakly associated with all these factors. Then what are the molecular alterations that are seen in squamous cell carcinoma? First, there are several genes that are playing critical roles in squamous cell carcinoma. First is the TP53, that is tumor suppressor gene. Then CDKN2A, that is cyclin dependent kinase inhibitor, and that encode for P14 and P16, that regulate the cell cycle. And PIK3CA, that is phosphatidyl inositol 3 kinase gene, that encodes the enzyme that phosphorylates the some signaling molecules that also regulate the cell cycle. And mutation of these genes, they are the drivers of the cancer development. Second is Notch pathway, that also associated with the cell cycle differentiation and regulation. And tumor suppressor, that is FAT1, that is a member of cadherin family. So second mutation of Notch pathway and tumor suppressor is also associated with the squamous cell carcinoma. And finally, the mutations identified in the HPV positive and HPV negative tumors were different. For example, HPV negative tumors harbor more somatic mutations than the HPV positive tumors. And in addition, due to the expression of HPV encoproteins, that is E6 and E7, they inactivate the P53 and RB pathways. As you know, P53 is the tumor suppressor pathway, and RB pathway, that is also responsible for the cell cycle arrest. So mutation in or inactivation of these pathways will lead to the oral cancer in HPV positive tumors. That is also same as in the cervical cancer. And despite this advanced understanding of molecular alterations, targeted therapies for reducing squamous cell carcinoma morbidity and mortality remain limited. Grossly, it may have the following types. One is the ulcerative type, that is the most frequent type, and it is characterized by the intubated ulcer and firm everted or rolled edges. So one is ulcerative type. Second is papillary or varicose type. It is soft and pod-like growth. Third is nodular type. It shows the firm and slow growing submucosal nodule. And fourth is serous type, that is characterized by the infiltration into the deeper structures. So these are the gross type of the squamous cell carcinoma. एंड ऑल दिस टाइप में अभी ऑन द बैकग्राउंड ऑफ द लिकोप्लेकिया, बिकॉज लिकोप्लेकिया और इरिथ्रोप्लेसिया दैट आर द प्री मेलिग्नेंट कंडीशन एंड एनलार्ज सर्वाइकल लिम्फ नोड्स मे समटाइम्स बी प्रेजेंट. सो दीज आर द ग्रॉस फोटोज अल्सरेटिव टाइप दैट शोज द अल्सर. Then this is the wart-like growth that is seen in papillary or varicose type. The nodular type that shows the nodule formation, and serous type that shows the deeper infiltration into the oral mucosa. Histologically, squamous cell carcinoma ranges from well-differentiated keratinizing carcinoma to highly undifferentiated neoplasm. Changes of epithelial dysplasia are often present in the surrounding areas of the lesion. And carcinoma of the lip and intraoral squamous cell carcinoma are usually always well differentiated. Then these are the microscopic picture. So this shows the epithelial dysplasia and that shows the invasive squamous cell carcinoma. Here you can see the hyperkeratosis, so increase in the keratin layer. Then irregular stratification of these epithelial layers. It shows the cellular pleomorphism and abnormal mitotic figures. So these are the abnormal mitotic figures and individual cell keratinization. And while few areas shows the invasive islands. So these are the invasive foci of the squamous cell carcinoma. Here also you can see this is the epithelial dysplasia. There is irregular stratification, cellular pleomorphism and hyperchromatism. And that may be the mitosis at some points. So these are the microscopic picture. Carcinoma of the lip has more favorable prognosis because it is visible and easily accessible location and less frequent metastasis to the regional lymph nodes. But intraoral squamous cell carcinoma have poor prognosis because they are detected late. And metastasis to regional lymph nodes occur early, especially in the case of CA tongue and soft palate. So lip has more favorable prognosis, but intraoral SCC that occurs on tongue and soft palate, they have poor prognosis. A varicose carcinoma has very good prognosis because they are composed of very well differentiated squamous epithelium and minimal ATPM. Then other malignant tumors, other less common malignant neoplasm which can be encountered in the oral cavity other than squamous cell carcinoma are malignant melanoma, that is the tumor of melanocytes, lymphoepithelial carcinoma, that is the malignant epithelial component with lymphoid stroma. So lymphoepithelial carcinoma shows malignant epithelial component. Then lymphoma and malignant tumors of the minor salivary glands. Various sarcomas can occur in the oral cavity, that is rhabdomyosarcoma, that is the tumor of the skeletal muscle, then liposarcoma, that is the tumors of adipose tissue, malignant tumors, alveolar soft part sarcoma, that shows the alveolar pattern, Kaposi sarcomas, and fibrosarcoma. Metastatic tumor can also occur in the soft tissue of the mouth from other sites. So up to this all is related to the some benign tumors and squamous cell carcinoma of the oral cavity. Then second component is the teeth. So this is the normal histology of the odontogenic apparatus. So it shows this is the enamel layer, then inside is dentin layer, then there is a pulp. Here this is the gingival sulcus. And outside is the cementum layer, then periodontal membrane, this is the root canal and alveolar bone. So tumor can arise from any of the components. Odontogenic tumors, they are the uncommon lesions of the jaw that are derived from the odontogenic apparatus. And these tumors are usually benign, but some have malignant counterparts. And this is the classification of the odontogenic tumors. So benign tumors are epithelial origin, these are the ameloblastoma, adenomatoid odontogenic tumor, calcifying epithelial odontogenic tumor, then mesenchymal origin are odontogenic myxoma, odontogenic fibroma and cementoma, and mixed epithelial mesenchymal origin are ameloblastic fibroma, ameloblastic fibroodontoma, and complex odontomas. And malignant tumors that arise from the epithelium are malignant ameloblastoma and ameloblastic carcinoma. And mesenchymal origin are ameloblastic fibrosarcoma. So we see ameloblastoma in detail. So ameloblastoma is the benign odontogenic tumor, and that is the most common benign, but it is locally invasive epithelial odontogenic tumor. Most frequently occur in the third to fifth decades of life, and preferential sites are the mandible and maxilla. And this tumor originates from the dental epithelium of the enamel itself or its epithelial residue. So it arises from the epithelium of the enamel. Grossly, the tumor is grayish white in color, usually solid, but it shows polycystic area that replace and expand the affected pore. Histologically, ameloblastoma shows different patterns. One is the follicular pattern, that is the most common, and the tumor consists of follicles of variable size and shape, and that are separated from each other by the fibrous tissue. The structure of follicle is similar to that of the enamel organ, consisting of central area of stellate cells resembling the stellate reticulum and peripheral layer of cuboidal or columnar cells that resemble the epithelium. And this central stellate area may show cystic changes. So this is the follicular pattern. So these are the follicles, and this is the central area that shows the stellate cells, and that there are presence of cystic change, and peripherally there is the columnar line, and this is the fibrous tissue. So these cystic areas are separated by the fibrous tissue. Other pattern is the plexiform pattern, that is next common pattern after the follicular pattern. And the tumor epithelium is seen to form the irregular plexiform masses or network of strands. Here you can see these are the plexiform masses of these cells. The stroma is usually scanty, and microcyst formation can occur in the stroma. So these are the cystic changes, and these are the epithelial masses, plexiform masses. So this is the plexiform pattern. Then acanthomatous pattern is squamous metaplasia within the islands of tumor cells. So here also presence of the squamous metaplasia. Basal cell pattern of the ameloblastoma is similar to basal cell carcinoma of the skin. And granular cell pattern is characterized by the appearance of the acidophilic granularity in the cytoplasm of the tumor cells. So these are the different patterns, and you can see combination of more than one morphologic pattern. And tumor cells in ameloblastoma exhibit the positive ISC for the cytokeratin, that is the epithelial marker, and laminin, as are seen in the developing tooth. Then malignant odontogenic tumors. These malignant odontogenic tumors are rare, but that can be present. So first is the malignant ameloblastoma. So when this term is used for the metastatizing ameloblastoma, when benign ameloblastoma that can metastatize to other side, that is the malignant ameloblastoma. Second is ameloblastic carcinoma. So this is the term that is employed for the ameloblastic tumor that have the cytologic features of malignancy in the primary tumor. And primary intraosseous carcinoma that may develop within the jaw from the rest of the odontogenic epithelium. And rarely, carcinoma may arise from the odontogenic epithelium lining the odontogenic cyst. So there are some benign cysts that may be present, that is dentigerous cyst, and carcinoma may arise from this epithelium that are lining this odontogenic cyst. So these are the malignant odontogenic tumors. Odontogenic sarcomas that can occur, and only example that is rare ameloblastic fibrosarcoma. So this is the mesenchymal origin malignant tumor that can occur, and this tumor resembles the ameloblastic fibroma, that is the benign part, but the mesenchymal component is in some malignant, that is sarcomatous. Whereas the epithelium, that is ameloblastic epithelium, that is remains differentiated and benign. So mesenchymal component is malignant here in ameloblastic fibrosarcoma. And then tumors of the salivary glands. So major as well as minor salivary glands can give rise to variety of benign and malignant tumors. Major glands, particularly the parotid glands, are the most common site. 85% it is affected, and majority of the parotid gland tumor are benign. Other major and minor salivary glands of the tumors are malignant. That is 35 to 50% of the tumors are malignant. And most of the salivary gland tumors that originate from the ductal lining epithelium, from SE9 or from the myoepithelial cells. So these are the normal histological components of the salivary glands. There is presence of duct as well as SE9 and this myoepithelial cells that surround this duct and SE9. So tumor can arise from any of these components. And recurrent tumors of the parotid glands, due to their location, are often associated with facial palsy and obvious scarring following the surgical treatment, because they are present near to the facial nerve, so that can give rise to the facial palsy. And this is the classification of the salivary gland tumors. Benign are adenomas. One is pleomorphic adenomas, also known as the mixed tumor, and that is most common. Then monomorphic adenoma. So there is only epithelial lining is affected, and the examples are Verdin tumors, also known as the papillary cyst adenoma lymphomatosum or adenolymphoma. Then auxiliary adenoma, also known as the oncocytoma, and other types are myoepithelioma, basal cell adenoma, clear cell adenoma, but they are uncommon. Mesenchymal tumors are also rare. And malignant tumors, most common is mucoepidermoid carcinoma and malignant mixed tumor. Malignant mixed tumor, examples are carcinoma in pleomorphic adenoma, carcinosarcoma, and metastatizing mixed salivary tumor. Then adenoid cystic carcinoma, acinic cell carcinoma, adenocarcinoma, epidermoid carcinoma, undifferentiated carcinoma, and miscellaneous. So this is the classification of the salivary gland tumors, benign and malignant. So most common is pleomorphic adenoma, that is mixed salivary tumor. It's the most common tumor of the major as well as the minor salivary glands. And pleomorphic adenoma is the commonest tumor in the parotid gland, and that is common in women, and third to fifth decade of life persons are commonly affected. This is the location of the pleomorphic adenoma, and grossly it shows the lobules of gray white circumscribed tumor. This is the circumscribed and gray white tumor that have the semilucent parenchyma. Microscopically, the epithelial component, these are the epithelial component that shows the ducts, SE9, tubules, or sheaths and strands. So these are the ducts. These are the strands, and these are the sheaths of the epithelial component that shows the cuboidal lining and myoepithelial cells, and that are admixed with the mesenchymal component that shows this pseudocartilage, which is matrix of myxoid or chondroid or mucoid material. And this is the normal salivary tissue. Here also the microscopic picture. This is the ductal component of the epithelium, and that is admixed with the normal ductal and myoepithelial cells, and that is admixed with the chondromyxoid stroma. So that is the characteristic feature of this pleomorphic adenoma. Then monomorphic adenomas, these are benign epithelial tumors of the salivary glands, but without any evidence of the mesenchyme-like tissues. Okay, so mainly epithelial component is affected, and their various forms are as under. One is the Verdin's tumor, also known as papillary cyst adenoma, lymphomatosum, or adenolymphoma. And this Verdin tumor that most commonly affect in the men, and each group of bacteria is 4th to 7th decade of life. Histogenesis of the tumor has been much debated, but most accepted the theory that the tumor develops from the parotid ductal epithelium that is adjacent to the lymph nodes. Grossly, the tumor is encapsulated, so they have well-defined capsule, round to oval with smooth surface. And the cut surface shows the characteristic cleat-like or cystic spaces. When you cut the tumor, there is a characteristic cystic spaces are present that contain the milky fluid and that have the papillary projections. And this is the microscopic picture that showing the, this is the epithelium. The cytoplasm is eosinophilic. The epithelium forms the glandular and papillary or cystic pattern and with intervening stroma of this lymphoid tissue. So this is the characteristic pattern, epithelium with lymphoid tissue. Here is the same microscopic picture. This is the eosinophilic epithelium that can forms the glandular, papillary or cystic pattern and with intervening lymphoid stroma. Then malignant salivary gland tumors. Most common is mucoepidermoid carcinoma. It is the most common malignant tumor. Salivary gland tumor both in major and minor glands. And parotid gland amongst the major salivary glands and the minor salivary glands in the palate are the most common site. So parotid gland is most commonly affected. Common age group affected is 30 to 60 years. But it is also the common malignant salivary gland tumor that affects the children and adolescent. And most common example of radiation induced malignant tumors, especially after therapeutic radiation. If you have taken radiation for other cause, there may be chances of development of this mucoepidermoid carcinoma at this site. Morphologically, the tumor is usually circumscribed, but it is not encapsulated. It is only circumscribed. It varies in size from 1 to 4 cm. And microscopically, the tumor is classified into low, intermediate and high grade depending upon the degree of differentiation and tumor invasiveness. So based on degree of differentiation and tumor invasiveness, it is classified into three types, low, intermediate and high grade. And microscopically, tumor is composed of combination of four types of cells. One is mucin producing cells, second is squamous type, intermediate cells and clear cells. Well differentiated tumors have predominance of these mucinous cells, while poorly differentiated have more solid and infiltrative pattern. So this is the microscopic picture of the mucoepidermoid carcinoma. These are the mucinous tumors and mucin producing cells. Here also there is a mucin inside the cells. Then these are the squamous cells and intermediate cells. And these are the intermediate cells. Clear cells are not seen in the picture. Second malignant type is malignant mixed tumor and it has three distinct entities. One is carcinoma that arise in the benign mixed salivary gland tumor, that is carcinoma arise in the pleomorphic adenoma. That is benign part. So it is known as the carcinoma ex pleomorphic adenoma. Second is carcinosarcoma. It has both the components are malignant, epithelial as well as mesenchymal. So it is known as the carcinosarcoma. And third is the metastatizing mixed salivary tumor. When mixed salivary tumor metastatizes, it is metastatizing mixed salivary tumor. So first is carcinoma ex pleomorphic adenoma, that is more common, and when there is a adenoma, it is slow growing adenoma, but when it have been present for a number of years and when it suddenly undergoes rapid increase in its size and becomes painful, and patient may develop the facial palsy when it convert into the malignant transformation. And this malignant transformation occurs in the later age, that is 6th decade. Then the usual is for the pleomorphic adenoma, that is 4 to 6 decades. and it may occur in the primary tumor, but carcinoma ex pleomorphic adenoma, that is more often seen when it is in recurrence. Morphologically, morphological features. So grossly, the tumor is poorly circumscribed with irregular and infiltrating margin, and cut section shows the presence of hemorrhage, necrotic and cystic degeneration. And microscopically, besides the typical appearance of this pleomorphic adenoma, there is presence of malignant areas that shows the cytological features of carcinoma, such as anaplasia, nuclear hyperchromatism, large nucleolization, that is large nucleoli, mitosis, and evidence of invasive growth. So these are the malignant areas. Then adenoid cystic carcinoma. So this is a highly malignant tumor due to its typical infiltrative nature, especially along the nerve sheath. So they infiltrate along the nerve sheath. And histologically, it is characterized by the cupriform appearance. And this cystic species contain the pars positive basophilic material. So this is the microscopic picture of the adenoid cystic carcinoma. Here you can see this is the cupriform pattern of the tumor cells. And these tumor cells are high anaplastic malignant tumor cells. And inside this cyst, there is a presence of basophilic material. So these are the morphological features of the adenoid cystic carcinoma. Then acinic cell carcinoma. It is a rare tumor, but it is composed of acinic cells that resemble the serous cells of the normal salivary glands. And these cells are arranged in sheets or acini, and they have the characteristic basophilic granular cytoplasm. The degree of atypia may vary from benign cytologic appearance to cellular features of malignancy. So third type is the acinic cell carcinoma, and remember that morphologically it shows the acinic cells that are arranged in sheets or acini, and they have the characteristic basophilic granular cytoplasm. Then adenocarcinoma of the salivary gland, that is not different from the adenocarcinoma that is seen elsewhere in the body. And it may be mucoid adenocarcinoma, clear cell adenocarcinoma, or papillary cyst adenocarcinoma. Epidermoid carcinoma, that is the rare tumor and has the features of squamous cell carcinoma, that shows the keratin formation and that has the intercellular bleaches similar to its appearance that is seen elsewhere in the body. And this tumor commonly infiltrates the skin and involves the facial nerve varially. Then undifferentiated carcinoma. So this highly malignant tumor that consists of anaplastic epithelial, which are too poorly differentiated. So we can't place it any other known category. So these are the undifferentiated carcinoma. And this is the last slide, that is miscellaneous malignant tumors, other malignant tumors. So these are the melanoma, that is tumors of the melanocytes, sebaceous carcinoma, so sebaceous glands that are present in the oral cavity that can give rise to the sebaceous carcinoma, undifferentiated carcinoma, that is very poorly differentiated carcinoma, lymphoma, so lymphoid tissue that is present as tonsil and adenoids that can give rise to the lymphoma, that is seen same as seen elsewhere in the body, fibrosarcoma, so these are the mesenchyma malignant parts, fibrosarcoma and leiomyosarcoma. So leiomyosarcoma is the mesenchymal origin of the sarcomatous component that involves the smooth muscles. And all these tumors are similar in morphology to such tumors that are seen elsewhere in the body. And besides metastatic involvement of the major salivary glands or the adjacent lymph nodes is also common, especially from the epidermoid and malignant melanoma. Thank you.